Gracias, Michael. Thanks, Ruth. And talking about varieties, now we have two experts on varieties, and they are leading the UF5S citrus breeding program. They are Drs. Fred Grimiter and Jude Grosser, and we'll be talking about new varieties that they are developing for us.
Great. It's back to me too. We're going to follow on this type of interview process. I know a number of the questions in the chat, and Jude and Fred, I know you're following in the chat, things about what to grow in Southwest Florida, things about resistance versus tolerance, et cetera. So let's talk, I'm going to start off with you, Dr. Grimiter. Can you just basically briefly describe, we don't want to assume that people know, what does the plant improvement team do? And then we'll jump over and talk about rootstocks and scions and varieties and get to Dr. Grosser as well. But can you just briefly explain what it does?
Sure. Basically, both Jude and I, well, we've worked together for several years now. And our objective, our goal for our program is to develop new opportunities, new kinds of varieties for future needs. We always understand that there are current needs, but citrus breeding being a long-term effort requires persistence and some vision of what the future might lead to. So we work on rootstocks to make rootstocks that are more adapted to different kinds of soils, capable of supporting healthier scions above, capable of producing high yields and good quality fruit. And we work on scions. We've worked to improve sweet oranges. When Jude and I started, this was a Hamlin and Valencia industry with a little bit of pineapple in the mid-season. Hamlin, a very poor quality orange. And we've worked very hard and successfully in developing new options for this industry such that they can have Valencia quality juice produced on citrus trees throughout the year. We've looked at a fresh fruit industry in the past that was based on grapefruit and a handful of seedy, not so easy to peel mandarins like Sunburst and Murcott. And we understood that the future was going to be seedless and easy to peel mandarins. And we've worked for many years and have, through our pipeline, generated a number of those that are very interesting, very productive, meeting the needs, and there are many more in the pipeline. We've worked on lemons. When we started to work on lemons, people thought we were a little bit crazy because, after all, there was no lemon industry in Florida. But fast forward, HLB and a lot of growers looking at lemons now as an HLB tolerant option for production. And here we are with some seedless high oil, high peel oil lemons that are available for our industry to take advantage of. So I guess in a summary statement, our goal and our objective is to have a suite of varieties available for whatever the future may hold for the industry.
Okay, so Fred, this is a real important point that I really want our participants to understand. We throw these terms around, resistance, tolerance. Could you talk about this? And I think it's very important that if you are in IFAS that you know the difference and that you use the proper terms. So could you just talk a little bit about that? We talk about a citrus greening resistant. We talk about citrus greening tolerant. What does that mean?
Well, resistant would mean that the plant essentially is completely unaffected by the pathogen. So for example, Clementine mandarin we know is resistant to Alternaria, which is a fungal problem on many mandarins. It's resistant. You can inoculate it and it doesn't develop the disease. A lot of people, and I see even in the chat, people are talking about Sugarbell as a resistant variety. It's not a resistant variety. Sugarbell can be infected by Liberobacter, the causal agent of HLB. It can support high titer of that pathogen. In the wintertime, you'll see a lot of blotchy mottled leaves on sugarbell. And if sugarbell trees are not properly cared for, you'll have a substantial number of HLB impacted fruit on sugarbell. So why are we even talking about it? Well, because with proper care, sugarbell has the potential to outgrow the problems that the pathogen brings to it. And this is what we would refer to as tolerance. I mentioned lemons as well, being tolerant. Lemons look really bad in the wintertime in Florida with HLB. But with good nutrition, good irrigation management, they'll put out a huge flush in the spring, virtually symptom-free, produce a crop of fruit, and just repeat that year in and year out. They outgrow the impacts of the disease. So this is what we mean by tolerant.
So we're, just to be clear, do we have any citrus in Florida that is citrus greening resistant?
No.
Okay. Clearly that's the goal.
Not yet.
Not yet, right. But we do have citrus in Florida that is tolerant, and that is?
Well, sugarbell is one, mm-hmm. Okay. For certain.
Okay, and that is what we're recommending for dooryard primarily.
Yes, that okay. And another sweet orange that also has appeared to be performing better in the face of greening than other sweet oranges.
And that, is that the OLL4?
Yes, ma'am.
All right, so that's a great segue to Jude. Jude, talk a little bit about our OLL varieties that you've been very hard on, along with, I mean, this is, you can't say one is, these guys are joined at the hip, you know, just like in anything, success has many fathers and failure is an orphan. So in breeding a citrus tree, it takes all of us to do that. It takes entomologists, it takes pathogen people. So anyway, Jude, could you talk a little bit about our rootstock work and our OLL varieties that I know you're very excited about?
Okay, I'll start with the OLL varieties, and the OLL originally stood for Ori Lee Late. Ori Lee is a deceased, brilliant citrus grower that is in the Citrus Hall of Fame, and he helped numerous researchers, but he's been incredibly important to my career. So we started working on the OLL oranges probably more than 20 years ago. And the OLL now has been changed to Ori and Louise Lee, is what it stands for now, because his wife continued to support our research program after Ori passed, and a lot of the work has been done on their property in the St. Cloud area. So these oranges, you compare them to Valencia, which is the gold standard for juice oranges in the world. The trees will grow off faster. The oranges are more attractive because they have darker external and internal color. The juice has just a really beautiful, rich orange color, even more so than standard Valencia. It's more comparable to the Rhodey Red Valencia. And we have found that in a program where the nutrition is optimized and you're providing all the needed micronutrients year round, that these trees can show a little more tolerance than you get with a standard Valencia. And so I'm growing some in my yard successfully. And so we think that if you do everything right, you can have a really nice orange that's attractive for both fresh. If you want to cut it up into segments or score it and pull the peels off, it's very nice to eat fresh. Or if you want to juice it, that's another really interesting thing about the OLL series. We've done quite a bit of juice taste panel organoleptic studies, and so have some of the orange juice companies, and they beat everything else in the taste test routinely. The OLL, excuse me, have never lost in a taste panel evaluation to Valencia, and they generally are favored over Valencia, which is, again, the gold standard.
So OLL4 is similar to Valencia. You know, it's very similar to Valencia. And would you say that, I know we're recommending sugarbell, because sugarbell can be grown a across the state. It can be grown in the panhandle, where OLL4 is not great in the panhandle, but it can be grown in the southwest part of the state as well. And correct me if I'm wrong. But are we also recommending OLL4, or are we encouraging people to perhaps do OLL, or maybe OLL20, or one of those OLL numbers? I mean, I get them all confused sometimes. So talk a little bit about that.
Well, we chose OLL4 because it's just looking at the whole package of traits. It seemed like a good one to start off with this initiative. And we may add more OLL selections as this program evolves. And regarding where to plant, Fred can comment on the cold hardiness of sugar bell. It's probably one of the most cold hardy scions available, in addition to having the HLB tolerance. So it's a natural for North Florida and the panhandle. Now, regarding the OLL4, it should do well in most parts of the state. And if you live in an area that doesn't routinely freeze before mid-February, I mean, if you don't have a, you know, below 28 event that's going to ruin your fruit, then it's a safe place to try the OLL4.
And what's the harvest window for OLL4?
Usually you can start getting it in mid-February, but I have encountered growers in the Indian River area that were actually picking it a few weeks earlier than this. But in Central Florida, it's generally mid-February, but the fruit holds on the tree very well too, so you can harvest it all the way into June.
So February through June would be a good time period for that. Yes. So. Okay, so gentlemen, let's talk a little bit, where are we on this breeding journey? We hear a lot of things about CRISPR and all of this. I mean, what do you look forward? You've been in this business for a while. What are you most hopeful for? What are you looking forward to? What gets you excited when you get up in the morning?
Coming in and seeing Jude.
Yeah.
So there's a lot of talk about CRISPR gene editing as a technology that's going to solve this problem. And don't get us wrong, we all hope that can be. And in fact, both Jude and myself have worked somewhat in the area in collaboration with some other folks as well, Manjul Dutt and John Aldang. Nian Wong, who works here at the CREC, has made a name for himself for CRISPR technology. The success of CRISPR is going to depend on successfully identifying gene targets for modification. And what we've learned over the past 16 years living with HLB, is that it's an extremely complicated disease. It impacts all aspects of the plant's metabolism. It impacts many aspects of the anatomy of the plant. You know, phloem gets plugged, starches accumulate, all sorts of things. My point is that it's going to be difficult to identify a single gene target that's going to be successful in making the plants resistant. And if you look at the history of humanity and our interaction with plants and pests, a single gene for resistance almost always results in the bacteria or the insect or whatever overcoming that single gene. So our approach is to look at CRISPR as a tool. It's certainly a valuable tool, a potentially valuable tool. It depends a lot on genomic research to identify the targets. And again, genomic research is another tool. So we sort of look at the integrative whole package of tools and our ability to improve the plant materials that we're developing.
And Ruth, you asked a little bit about the rootstock before, and I saw one of the questions on the chat line about the pH of the soil, and the pH of the soil is critical, and you'll hear more about that from our horticulturists coming up, but the point I want to make is that with rootstocks, we are working with a tremendous amount of genetic diversity, and we're trying to find rootstocks that will do the job for all the different conditions in the state. So if you live on a coastal area and you have a problem with salt in your water or salt intrusion or, you know, blowing off from the ocean or whatever, we have salinity tolerance now in our rootstock germplasm. They're going to help trees overcome this. For the north part of the state, we know that the rootstock is very important for getting trees to go dormant in the wintertime and protecting them, and also making smaller trees that are, you know, less exposed to the cold and easier to protect with water. So all of these things go into our planning, and there's going to be an evolution of rootstocks that will quickly move into the dooryard program as it evolves that will match your needs. And this is an exciting, I think this is really exciting because it's also, of course, going to contribute to the tree's ability to handle the HLB. So you can look for that sort of thing as the program evolves. The other point I'll make in that regard is that we're not just testing new rootstocks with only oranges. Actually, we're putting some of the most susceptible varieties on the newer rootstocks to see how they do. I mean, we're working with the honey murcott, which is probably the most susceptible variety we have, and grapefruit, which is tough, and hamlins. And so we're testing all these on the new rootstocks in order to most quickly identify which ones can actually, you know, mitigate the disease. And then we can eventually get all of your favorite old time varieties back into the dooryard situation. So that's where the evolution is going.
So before we open it up to questions, I want to go back to Fred for a minute and talk about grapefruit, because grapefruit is one of those things that is very susceptible to HLB. We know that, but we know people love their grapefruit. And while we're not recommending anything for the dooryard just yet, can you just give us a little bit of a preview of what's going on with grapefruit in Florida?
Yeah, when HLB arrived to Florida and we watched it move across the state, one of the first conclusions was that grapefruit were really tolerant of HLB, more so than oranges. That turned out not to be the reality. Oranges decline, and they decline to a certain level and stabilize, whereas grapefruit seem to go down a lot farther across the long term. We've been developing grapefruit hybrids, usually using pumelo germplasm. And some of these have caught the attention of industries outside of Florida. There's one that we call UF914 that we first released it because we found out it didn't contain furanocoumarins, which are the chemicals that are responsible for the drug interaction associated with grapefruit. But since we haven't been able to conduct a large-scale clinical trial to prove that it's safe, although we've tested it with cell cultures. We don't talk too much about the furanocoumarin anymore, though it is very low. But what we do talk about is the quality of the 914. It matures earlier than standard grapefruit. It has higher soluble solids, lower acidity. We've done taste panel testing with it, and people who hate grapefruit like it. People who like grapefruit like it, so it's a win-win all the way around. It's not particularly tolerant of HLB. When growers ask me how it holds up, I say it's not worse than grapefruit, and that's usually enough for them to turn and walk away. But Arnold Schumann's been growing 914 in his cups for the past several years now, and it's as productive, if not more productive, in cups than standard grapefruit, and produces just superior quality fruit. And so there may come a point in time where we might consider 914 as perhaps not a dooryard grapefruit variety, but one that might be grown, you know, under screen, you know, next to your pool in your lanai area. Mm-hmm. We have found some other hybrids of grapefruit with similar fruit quality to the 914 that are holding up a little bit better against HLB than standard grapefruit. We've propagated these and we'll be testing these to see if in fact that is the case on a larger scale, but we're optimistic based on what we've seen so far.
Thank you. So basically, to summarize until we get questions, is that we have OLL4, which is tolerant to HLB. We have Sugar Bell, which we're recommending for the dooryard. And then we also have some progress in grapefruit, and that, excuse me, there's this difference between resistance and tolerance. So let's open it up to some questions. Wendy, do you have anything in the chat box that we could ask our breeders here?
Yep, they were wondering if the OLL4 will be sold under that name. Is that the name that we're gonna look for that cultivar? And is it available in the market yet?
Yes, that is the name that you'll see. And I think some of the nurseries are making it available. So you'd have to do your homework, and we may be able to help you with that.
Right. And I think that's about where we are right now. Nikki Monroe over in Indian River County said that, you know, this would be a dream for condo owners, some of the smaller varieties. So, yeah. And that's, Jeff Wazalewski from Miami-Dade wants to know how these varieties are going to do in high pH soil. And Barbara Edmonds over in Levy County, who has sometimes salt issues as well, is wondering about pH and salt.
That's a difficult question to ask, but actually it would be nice to hook up with some of these people that have a documented problem with the salinity, and maybe it would be a good opportunity for us to send a few research trees down to test, basically using better rootstocks to try to fix the problem. So there are also some soil amendments that you can do to help adjust the pH, which you'll probably hear about later in the webinar. But I would like to pursue, getting some of our new salinity tolerant rootstocks with some of these dooryard varieties on them into your environment. Let's just see how they do. That would be very useful.
Some of our rootstocks that have been released also were selected for tolerance of high pH and calcareous soils. So the solution for the high soil pH in Miami-Dade County or salinity is going to be a rootstock solution. And if we have rootstocks that are suitable for those conditions, then the Sugar Bell and the OLL4 should do well. It's really a rootstock solution.
Okay, and then we also have a little bit of a comment, and I just want to hear, I think they want to hear back what CREC's philosophy is on this. And so it says, thanks for the information. Encouraging homeowner citrus at this time is still a gamble. Trees aren't inexpensive, and the ones mentioned are not readily available in my area. Homeowners are not likely to maintain a pesticide program because of the misinformation about the dangers of using pesticides in general. Tolerant varieties do not mean resistance to HLB. Yep, we covered that. So there is great potential in new citrus trees may not reach maturity. Isn't it too soon to start up the dooryard citrus program? And I asked this question to you, the Orange Brothers, as you're known, but also I asked this question to Home Depot and Lowe's and Ace Hardware and our local retail centers as well. But Dr. Grosser, if you would comment on that, please.
Well, you know, if you go in to one of these stores now, the Lowe's or the Home Depot's, there's a lot of citrus trees available and they're moving. There's a lot of people that are willing to take a gamble. And so since, you know, I'm growing Sugar Bell and OLL in my yard successfully, so I know for a fact that it can be done. And so I feel like it is time to try to give the consumer better options than what they have now, than what they're already spending their money on. Of course, it's not going to work for everyone. I mean, you might do something wrong, or you might have a very unusual weather season that makes your tree not productive during a particular year. But overall, I think the majority of people that get these new varieties and do all the right things growing them, which will not, you know, demand the overuse of scary chemicals at all. I think most people can be successful and have some fruit coming from their yard.
Yeah, I think the real point is what you'd mentioned, you go to the box stores and you see trees for sale. I've seen Sunburst Tangerine, for example. And our growers will tell you that Sunburst has been a disaster. It's vanished from Florida, not only because it produces seedy fruit, but because it's really sensitive to HLB. But people are buying them and planting them. So we feel that we have better options. And we are going slowly. We're right. Just talking about Sugar Bell right now and the OLL4, where we've had some pretty good experience and seen that we can make it a go with these. Now, the people who plant trees in their yard, I think there are probably two kinds of people. There are people who just stick a tree in the ground and think, I got a citrus tree now in my yard and everything's going to be fine. And then the other type of person is someone who's, you know, a serious, avid home gardener. I put myself in that category. I live in Central Florida in a cold pocket in Lakeland, but I've got avocados and lychees and mangoes and longans in my backyard. And I know, you know, I'm at risk, but I take some extra effort to make sure those things grow. I've got a 7-year-old papaya tree. So there are people who are serious hobbyists about growing plants in their yard. And those are the kind of people that, you know, given the right information and better varieties, I think have a good chance to make a go of it. We're not guaranteeing anything. We're not encouraging. We're offering again these opportunities for people to move ahead and try something new and different.
Everything that was said in that comment we share the same concerns. Yet people are going to want to buy citrus, and for the sophisticated gardener, it's doable. And the reality is why are we talking with all of you? Why did we have a seminar for master gardeners? Because we know that information is power in this situation, and that we do have to go slow. We have to go slow because some of the questions in the chat box are, where are we going to get these trees? And that is a real problem in supply. And we're going to talk about that with nurseries, because Sugar Bell isn't necessarily sold at Lowe's and Home Depot. So we are working with nurseries to say, okay, you can get it from this nursery, which are commercial nurseries. We're also working with some new programs that we may be able to sell Sugar Bell through Master Gardener plant sales, because we think that we can help be broker getting supplies to them. So I'll talk more about that near the end of this. So there are some real challenges with this program that we acknowledge, and we appreciate that input as well. There are some good other questions. Wendy, did you want to address that? There's a one about rootstocks, and then there's a couple, like what are the varieties grown in high pH soil in Miami-Dade County?
Right. Well, we did talk about the pH soil from Miami-Dade.
Okay.
But the Fahim is wondering, what is the best rootstock you can use for saline soil or high pH? Do you have that rootstock identified?
Well, the we have a lime trial down in Homestead, and we do have one hybrid of sour orange and trifoliate 50-7 that is not commercially released, but it's doing good in the trial there for cropping and also producing a high quality fruit. But these new ones in the pipeline just have long coded numbers at present, and we can talk with the people that are interested following the webinar and maybe try to work out some kind of a plan to get a few of these in your hands down there to test. That would be a really nice thing, I think.
Okay, great. I went ahead and put the person's name who was asking in the chat box, so we can also have that in as part of the recorded version. So we know Miami-Dade County, Levy County, and Fahim El-Barai is are interested in those for the salt tolerance. And I think that wraps it up. Yep.
So this is a big point of why we wanted to have this conversation like this today, is to make these connections that we haven't really nurtured over the last 15 years. So we need to ramp this up again. And it's kind of like priming a pump. You need to kind of put this in. It takes a little bit of effort and time. And so we know that we have to take a long view on this. It's especially working with consumers. I know that I can't go out and tell people, go buy a sugar bell, because they're going to want to go down to the store tomorrow and buy a sugar bell. And they're going to get frustrated because they're not going to be able to find that there. So this is an issue that we are trying to deal with. And we'll talk about this with John Buettenmiller in his section. But we want everyone to understand this. And this is part of the purpose of today. So thank you for those comments. Thank you for the engagement, and thank you to Jude and Fred. Stay tuned for more good news, etc. So we'll get it back to Fernando now. I think we've used our 30 minutes almost. So thanks very much, all.
Thank
thanks,
you.
Thanks, everyone.
Thank you. You can see the sugar bell fruit behind me. They're big.
Thank you.
Sorry. Ruth. Wait, one thing. Just let me make a, I'm sorry. So, if you have not registered and plan to attend our open house and field day on November 16th, I strongly encourage you all to do that, because on that day, there's also a fruit display. So I don't know if Sugar Bell will be done there, but you'll be able to taste some of these new varieties that are being tested, et cetera. So I will put that in the chat box on how to register for that too. That went out to IFAS and all yesterday as well. So I strongly encourage you to attend. Thank you. I had to get the commercial in there.
Thank you. Thank you, Jude. Thank you, Fred. Thank you, Ruth.